This is Michael Renner. You might have seen him before. Some conference, talking about Postgres. Today, encryption after Heartbleed and NSA. So, have fun.
Okay, first, hello. My name is Michael Renner. I come from Vienna in Austria, a small country next to Germany. And I've worked in the IT for the last 15 years with a strong focus on operations, systems, administration tasks. I was always interested in security, but never took it up professionally. So please take all the details I'm talking, especially when we're looking at the details of TLS with a grain of salt. And if you have to correct me somewhere, please do so. Otherwise, other questions I would ask you to note down for until after the talk, because I have lots of material prepared and I don't want to get stalled too badly. So, but to start, I want to make a quick poll. Who of you has already enabled forward secrecy on their web servers or internet-facing servers? Okay. And who was affected by the Heartbleed bug and has already patched it? Okay, the people who answered yes to all three questions can probably leave the room because it's not too much new there. For all the others, I'll just start. First, we need to say that the internet is a scary place because most people just want to communicate in private, make sure that only they are the people who can read the communication, they and the communication partner, of course. And we wanted to be safe from manipulation, trickery, imposters. But since the internet is a culmination of human society, there are lots of people in there too which don't have the best interests in mind. This was the reason why they invented SSL in 1994, which was standardized and implemented by Netscape back then. And everybody rejoiced because suddenly it was possible to do safe online banking, safe shopping, safe exchanging of naughty pictures with your significant other, and things were good. But as we noticed quite fast is that implementations aren't forever, and the fortress of cryptography got its first cracks pretty early on. So over the last 20 years, there have been lots of things which we once thought to be secure, broken. We had SSL 2.0, which got broken pretty fast. We had MD5, RC4, which by now completely broken. And also SSL 3.0 has some unfixable flaws in the standard, which is a good reason to not use it anymore. This was addressed mostly by TLS 1.0, which was standardized in 1999. And they had 5 years of experience in hostile internet environments to address the most glaring security issues they noticed. And we thought with TLS everything is going to be fine and we don't need to touch cryptography anymore because everything is going to be okay. But as we learned in the last 5 years, TLS isn't as good as we expected either. We had attacks on renegotiation, we had Beast, we had Grime and Breach, which took advantage of the compression features in the TLS stack, we had Lucky 13, and even the secure hashing algorithm 1 had its first cracks, which makes it less secure than basically the amount of brute force it would take to compute the hash values. So as a systems administrator, we wait for vendor updates mostly, we install updated libraries, maybe restart all the daemons which use the libraries, and we hope for the best. And then suddenly, when we're done installing the updates, we notice that the IPv4 address space runs out, and people have questions like, can I use this SSL certificate on my web host? And we noticed that we are going to need server name indication support in our software. So server name indication for the people who haven't used it so far, basically sends the host name the client wants to connect to in the TLS handshake so that the server can look if he has a fitting certificate which fits the host name and send this back instead of the default configured one. Sounds like a good idea. The implementation is almost 5 years old, which means the Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6 also supports it. But as soon as you ask a customer if he expects to have any users using Windows XP and you get a yes back, things are down to step one and you can't use SNI. But hopefully this is going to be fixed in 2015 with Windows XP support finally running out. But in the end, what we are mostly interested in is that we get a nice, cute little lock symbol in the address bar in your browser, because this is what mostly counts, at least for the users. And if the users are happy, we are happy. And we hope that this cute little lock symbol will hold all the Eastern European mobsters and Nigerian scammers at bay, so that the communication of our users is secure. But then we read about things like APT. I don't mean any package managers there, but the topic of advanced persistent threats. And this was a definition I picked off of Wikipedia, which basically states that advanced persistent threats is a set of stealthy and continuous hacking processes often orchestrated by human targeting a specific entity. APTs usually targets organizations and or nations for business or political motives. We read this and we think, maybe our little lock symbol won't cut this slack anymore. But we think advanced persistent threats is usually just done by really bad people. And if we think about really bad people, it's usually Russians or Chinese, because nobody else would do something like this. But then this guy comes along and tells us that it's not probably the Chinese or Russians we should be mostly worried about when it comes to advanced persistent threats, but a group of countries which we wouldn't have expected it from. So Edward Snowden worked for a subcontractor of the NSA, and he took a few documents with him, which basically gave us a status report of the capabilities of 5 to 3 years ago. So all of the publications we've seen in the last few months are all very old news for them. And all of these five countries, which are probably the former crown colonies of the British Empire, started a big eavesdropping circle, and when the rest of the world started shouting at them and saying, oh, this is not fine what you're doing and you should stop it, James Clapper, I think the NSA spokesman, told them, I don't know why you're making such a big fuss, all of you are doing it too. And it turns out it was right. Because most of the other European countries had cooperation agreements or were in conversations with the NSA or the GCHQ to overcome legal and technical hurdles in starting to intercept the communication of their own citizens. So all of this is more or less documented. And even my country, Austria, wasn't spared by this, because in the past, the Austrian cybercrime doctrine was there is no cybercrime in Austria. This Monday, there was a paper leaked from the Ministry of Interior, which also outlined a cooperation agreement between our Heeresnachrichtenamt and the GCHQ. And we should have known better in Austria, because Austria is home to many Central and Eastern European headquarters, as well as a big United Nations office, so it absolutely makes sense to intercept this communication there. So, if we look at all these revelations, the question is, what did we learn from these revelations? And I came to the conclusion, for me personally, that if you send data over a link that carries a lot of data, for example, a big transatlantic fiber, or if you're on a connection which carries interesting data, like you're sitting next to a United Nations office, it's very likely that all your communication will be compromised. And to give this abstract threat a bit more substance, I'm going to do a quick round of intelligence community eavesdropping program name jeopardy. And I'm going to start out with an easy one, with Tempora. Does anybody of you know what Tempora actually is? Do you also want to share it? So Tempora is a wiretapping program run by GCHQ in cooperation with various carriers. They've got cooperation agreements with companies like British Telecom, Interroute, Level 3, Verizon, Global Crossing, Viadel, or Vodafone, which basically allows the GCHQ to install wiretaps on lines operated by these companies, enabling them to do things like this. This is a slide from the Muscular program, where they focused on decrypting proprietary communication protocols. Because so GCHQ was able to listen on in the communication of all the users in the internet, which is on the left-hand side, and they noticed that all of the users are using SSL connections nowadays, which makes them pretty hard to crack and to analyze what they are talking about with Google. And so they noticed, okay, if we can't monitor these links on the left side, let's just monitor all the links between the Google data centers, which were completely unencrypted back then, and which still had enough information about the queries and the users who did these queries for them to be able to reconstruct the actual queries. And which brings me to a big question. Is anybody of you using MPLS across data centers? Without encryption, VPN, or anything like this? Would be a prime example of what kind of information these intelligence community entities have access to. The Quantum Suite is another interesting program, which is a series of tools and probes which allows the intelligence community to do man-on-the-side attacks. These are attacks where the agency doesn't sit between the user and the web server, but on the side. There's another great slide which outlines this in the documentation dump by Edward Snowden. So basically what they did is if you have, for example, a user which talks to a server at Facebook.com, which is in the internet, and since the intelligence community has access to the internet, they can basically see that this user has a web browser window open to Facebook.com with a long polling connection which Facebook could then use to push down instant status updates. And so they noticed it, this and copy down the information, pass it on to Traffic Thief, which is a target selector program. And basically, when they notice, okay, I've got a user who's got a long polling connection open to Facebook, which matches one of the user IDs we are interested in, they are going to send out a TCP answer packet, which has a correct source destination port, source destination IP, correct TCP sequence number, because they know all of this information, along with malware payload, which is probably 0 day, so there is no protection against it so far, and they've got infected the user. And this is a program which is, according to documentation, used on a regular basis to own people or users which they wouldn't get a hold at otherwise. And this is only possible because they've got this huge sensor network where they can capture most of the traffic which is of interest to them. A bit of a novel idea, I thought, was DiscoRoute. Do you know Rancid, the router configuration and switch backup tool? Well, turns out if you do a telnet session to a switch or a router over the internet, which is monitored by them, and do a show running config over this connection, they will save a backup of your configuration for you. This was part of the iHunt sysadmin programs, where they were interested in the access lists configured on the routers to be able to pin down the specific IP address ranges where systems administrators might be located in. Because if they can own the network operators or system operators, they can automatically or in further get access to the networks that people operate. And there are links to this in the link collection, which I'm going to show you that will after the talk. There was also the Bullrun and Turmoil programs. Bullrun was a pretty high-level one, focused on breaking weak encryption and also introducing weak encryption in software and devices like VPN routers, mobile devices, and so on. And Turmoil was a program to use either stolen keys or broken keys to decrypt traffic on the fly. So again, a slide from the NSA documents leaks. So on top of this slide, you've got two computers apparently having an IPsec connection, and the traffic passes through a program called Hammerstein, which is the name of a malware they usually install on routers. For example, if they can't intercept this data on one of the fiber links, they can install malware on routers. And what Hammerstein does is that it copies all the VPN traffic over to Turmoil, which then, if it has access to the keys, can do metadata extraction or copy complete decrypted content over to their own document store. And to make things more interesting, they also have some man-in-the-middle attack capabilities where they can redirect traffic to something called CA resources. So it's also very likely that the intelligence community can create certificates on the fly for things which are interesting to them. Which brings us to the big question, are they allowed to do this? What we know so far is that all intelligence agencies operate within legal frameworks which allow the things they are doing, but that they usually are not very keen on following the spirit of the law, the constitution, Grundgesetz or Verfassung. So at the moment, this is the status quo and what they are doing. And more likely or not, if they've got access to data over an official interface, a law enforcement interface, for example, in Germany, the SINA boxes, which are hosted all mail providers, I think we can accept that this data can and will be compromised by the intelligence agencies. And the bad thing is that we are even paying them for it, because this is all taxpayer money, and they're on a mission to hunt terrorists, communists, whatever the scapegoat of the current hour is. And they are not going to be stopped anytime soon. I've got lots of time, cozy government jobs, and spend the time working on things to make our privacy and our collective lives worse. And this is rather bad, but it's not entirely hopeless, because a repeated occurrence in all the slides so far was that proper crypto is still very hard or nearly impossible for them to break. For example, the Tor project, which I'm wearing a t-shirt right now from, is still something which is rather complicated for them to address. So our task at hand is to improve our cryptographic stance and improve the level of security we offer our users. But to be able to do this, we need to know a bit about cryptography in the first place. And if we look at the things cryptography should do for me, it's usually four very high-level tasks. First and foremost, the most obvious one is that cryptography should enable privacy for us, so that nobody else is listening in on our communications. It should provide integrity so that nobody can modify our communication without us knowing it. It should provide us identification so that we know that the remote end we are talking with is actually the one we want to talk with. And non-repudiation is a rather big word, which basically means that neither side can deny that a given communication has taken place. And to build such cryptographic systems, you always have a set of building blocks, which are the same regardless if you're looking at Kerberos, IPsec or SSH, you always find variants of these building blocks in there, which start by ciphers, which encrypt the data as we know it. We've got private or session keys, which are used by the ciphers to ensure that only I and the other person knowing the specific key can decrypt the communication. We've got key exchange protocols, which are used to agree on a specific session key without having to actually expose my private key. We've got identification mechanisms which identify the remote server, which in today's internet is usually DNS-based host names and X509 certificates, signing these, basically saying, okay, I'm valid for this host name. We've got signature algorithms which are used to sign data, basically stating, okay, this piece of data is from me, so I'm stating that this is correct. And also hash functions which compute a fingerprint for a given file. For example, like MD5 or SHA-1, and the latter both examples are probably the things most of you have seen already, because when you download an Ether image, you usually get a MD5 or SHA-1 fingerprint, and if it's a sane distribution, it also provides a GPG signature for this fingerprint to authenticate it. So these are the building blocks, but in the real world, when we talk cryptography, most people are using TLS. TLS is a prevalent secure socket communication layer, was implemented as SSL back in 1994 by Netscape and continuously improved. It's used for most TCP-based applications. For example, if we look at HTTP, SMTP, IMAP, etc., most of these are offered in secure variants secured by TLS. The interesting thing about TLS is that there's a handshake which is done before any application data is actually transmitted on the TCP connection. And as soon as the connection is established, the whole TLS session is almost invisible to the underlying application. And if you're using TLS, we most likely have already seen a cipher seed string, like this one up here, which defines which of the building blocks we've talked before are going to be used for the specific TLS session. So cipher suites can have multiple parts. This one has four, which describe the different building blocks. For example, here we've got DHE, which stands for Diffie-Hellman key exchange, so ephemeral Diffie-Hellman key exchange, which is used to agree on a session cipher between both ends. We've got an authentication algorithm, which is RSA in this case, which is used to verify that the server we are talking with actually has the private key, which it claims to possess with the public key in the certificate. We've got a cipher algorithm, which is AES-256 in this case, which is used to basically encrypt all the data with the key we've exchanged with DHE. And we also have a message authentication code, which is used to authenticate all the data, which gives us the security that none of the data has been modified in transit. So, what's important is that both the server and the client need to support at least one common cipher suite, because otherwise they won't be able to communicate with each other. And to agree on a cipher suite and also exchange lots of other information, there's a TLS handshake at the beginning of each connection, which usually involves at least two round trips. In the beginning, before we start here, the client has established a TCP connection, so we've got a SYN, which is responded by a SYN ACK from the server, and then it starts usually with a client hello, where the client sends the wanted TLS version and a list of supported cipher suites that the client can accept. The server then responds with a server hello message, where he locks down on a specific, so it basically it acknowledges that the TLS version the client has selected is supported, and it also picks one of the cipher suites offered by the client, and it should usually be the strongest one. And it also sends back the certificate of the server, in the certificate there's a public key enclosed, which fits the private key which is configured on the server. So when the client has got the certificate and also the public key of the server, it sends a client key exchange message, where the client on its own sends the missing key material server to the server so that they can agree on a common session key. And also included in this message is a change cipher spec message, which states all messages after change cipher spec are to be encrypted and authenticated by the key and the cipher suite we have agreed upon up until now. And the finished message, which is sent last in the handshake, is then already authenticated and encrypted. The server receives the client key exchange message, takes the key material included there, and also sends back a changed cipher spec message and a signed and authenticated, encrypted and authenticated finished message. And when both ends of the connection have seen a finished message, the TLS handshake is complete, and beginning with this point, all of the communication is completely encrypted and secured with the cipher suite the server and client have agreed upon. And it's important to note that all of the things which happen up until the change cipher spec point are completely plain text out in the open and auditable. Which brings us to the certificates, because they are also a rather important part of TLS-based systems. X509 certificates, as they use today, bind a public key to a common name and other attributes which are included in the certificate. They are signed and issued and signed by a certificate authority. Those certificate authorities can be nested, but a TLS client has to trust the respective root certificate authority. Otherwise, it raises a TLS alert. Usually, the certificate authorities, or the ones which are to be trusted, are managed by your browser or operating system vendor. Most enterprise environments also install their own certificate authorities as well. If you look at a typical example of a TLS X509 certificate, we see that they have a chain of a chain on top. So this is a certificate for www.bettercrypto.org, which is signed by the Startcom class 1 intermediate server CE, which is then signed by the Startcom certification authority, which is the company behind Start SSL.com, for example. And we see that this this certificate is valid for the common name www.bettercrypto.org and the email address aaron@lowres.org, but both of these fields are rather legacy, and the real deal is way down in the certificate in the extensions. So most most browsers are most TCP clients should look for a subject alternative name flag in there, and there we've got two DNS names for which this certificate is going to be valid. So in this case, it's just bettercrypto.org and www.bettercrypto.org. And basically, with this certificate, if I trust the Startcom certification authority, I can connect to these names without my TLS clients raising any errors. Fortunately, this is not all TLS can do for us. There are also lots and lots of extensions which are already existing. The most important ones are, for example, a server name indication I already talked about, which is great if you want to do a proper name-based virtual hosting with TLS support. Secure renegotiation allows me to securely do an additional TLS handshake in an existing session because previous implementation had issues where somebody could inject custom data in existing connections. And more often than not, there are also new cipher suites introduced via extensions like ESGCM, Camellia, and so on. And when we're looking at the TLS from a performance point of view, we also need to be aware that TLS connections bring out bring in a considerable overhead, because the amount of round trips I need to take before I can send an request, for example, if we look at an HTTP client, when I want to do a single GET request over an unencrypted connection, I usually have one round trip before I can send my HTTP requests, which is basically the SYN from the client to the server, which is answered by a SYN ECK, and then I can send my GET request. If I'm using a full TLS handshake, for example, with a server which doesn't support resuming, this takes not one round trip, but three round trips, because I need to do a few complete TLS handshake, and only then I can send application data. And with session resumption, I can get this back down to two round trips, which makes it a bit more lightweight and easy again. And there are two mechanisms which we can use to support resume TLS handshakes. Session IDs for one, with session IDs, all TLS state resides on the server doing the SSL termination. The server hands out a session ID, and if a client sends a session ID in a client hello packet, the server can see if this is still valid and restore the TLS state. With session tickets, all the state is stored completely on the client, encrypted by a key chosen by the server, which makes it easier to operate in case you've got a cluster of SSL servers which all should be able to resume TLS sessions without having to do stuff like server pinning, where a certain client is always ending up on the same SSL headend. But yeah, so much for the theory. Anything obviously wrong in here? Okay. So picking up where we left off, with all the governments gobbling up our communications data, the situation is not only horrible, but also horribly complex if we look at all the details. And there are lots of areas where errors can be introduced. But fortunately, we are not alone in this, because as outraged as probably most of you were when they heard about this for the first time, also many security researchers were as outraged as we were. And in the last few, even in the last year, there have been many people writing about this thing. There have been a few high-level papers published by the IETF and similar organizations, basically saying that this constant and overboarding monitoring is an attack on the on the structure of the internet, and this needs to be addressed in the protocol design. So they said, okay, you can't just accept expect that your users fix these issues, but you need to be sure that your protocol fixes this. Which in turn inspired lots of work on actual protocols, for example, TLS 1.3, which is currently being drafted, tries to get rid of all the insecure cipher suites which are still in use or at least supported these days. XMPP, the underlying protocol of all the Java services, locked down the specification, basically banning all insecure protocols and requiring that all the communication is encrypted. And there's also been lots of research into start TLS and vulnerabilities in the implementation, because there have been issues with IMAP, XMPP, and so on, where it was possible to inject data in the sessions. And then there's also been lots of scientific research and code audits. We already heard about the Project Bull Run, and there's even an independent Project Bull Run at projectbullrun.org, which tries to document all the things the NSA did in the past. There was a famous case of the NSA proposing a random number generator, which was seriously flawed because it produced predictable random numbers, which is usually not the thing you want from random numbers. And there have also been government independent crypto competitions organized by Dan Bernstein, which tried to basically decouple the search for new ciphers from actual project sponsors, for example, by the American NIST Institute. And there have been also many critical errors which were fixed in 2014. There were new TLS issues. Apple had a major certificate validation issue. Curl had its issues. And as I've been writing the presentation, Heartbleed came out, which basically exposed random memory from the server or the client, which could include the private keys of the server. So these all are rather horrible, but unfortunately people start to actually look at the actual implementations. On a side note, I think the X509 public key infrastructure model we are using with certificates these days is horribly flawed and needs to be augmented or completely replaced. Because at the moment, this was a figure from a paper with the title "You won't be needing these anymore" on removing unused certificates from the trust store. They audited all the trust stores of various operating systems and browser vendors on the left, and they found that 431 unique certificate authorities are allowed to sign any certificate on the whole globe, as long as it's in the respective trust store. And what they did is they wanted to know how many of these 431 certificate authorities are actually used today. So they worked on a university, they sniffed all the TLS traffic there for 2 months and checked which certification authority was used to sign all the service certificates they encountered. And they also did a ZMAP scan of the internet, so basically contacting every IP address in the IPv4 space, checking if the server offered a certificate, and if yes, noting it down. And they noticed that of these 431 unique certificate authorities, 148 were completely unused. So they have never signed a single certificate they could see on the internet. So they said, okay, of these 148, we can probably remove 140 immediately, improving the security without any noticeable effect. But they also noticed that there were 8 certificate authorities which were implemented in all of the major operating systems, so from Windows down to, which one is this, to CentOS, OpenSUSE. So they took up lots of money and time to actually get in the trust store, but they never signed a single certificate. So this makes them highly suspectly, makes them very, very suspected of being just backup CAs for in case somebody very important needs a certificate signed in a short manner, which is accepted by most operating systems. And even if we remove this 148, we are still left with over 150, 200 certificate authorities which can still sign every certificate, which isn't a good way to start things. Luckily, people have been working on alternatives, so none of these has gained significant movement up to now. One is Dane, which uses custom DNS entries to basically say, okay, this certificate is allowed to be used for communication on this hostname, and it uses DNSSEC to actually validate this data. It's still a government-operated public key infrastructure with DNSSEC and one key on top, which is allowed to sign all of the records. But at least it's one step in the right direction. Tech, which can be found at tech.io, is a keypinning extension for TLS, where TLS server operators can specify other private keys, other certificates, which are allowed to communicate on behalf of a specific hostname. And there's also the certificate transparency project, which is currently spearheaded by Google, which basically try to record all valid certificates, so that the browser has an additional point of information to verify if the certificate that's used in the communication is actually valid, or if it's just something people insert on a man-in-the-middle basis. But all of them are still a few years out till they are complete replacements. So these are all the things people are doing for you. But you also need to get moving to provide a safe communication environment. And the most obvious thing is to use TLS in the first place, especially if you're communicating over the internet. I know it's hard and it's quite a bit of pain to actually get everything secured, especially when bugs like Heartbleed come out, where you have to basically reissue all the certificates. But not using TLS makes the life for intelligence agencies and other adversaries so much easier, because it's quite easy to sniff up all the data which is sent unencrypted. So if you use encryption, then the collective lives get much and much harder. Another thing which we learned is that you should not use only maintained software, but also recent software. Because Windows XP or Red Hat Enterprise Linux still is supported, it doesn't mean that it's actually a good and sound and secure basis for communication, because all the old systems don't support any recent cipher suites. Most of them don't support forward secure cipher suites, which is a huge issue. Thirdly, use sufficiently sized keys and hashes, because the best cipher suite is pointless when the key you use is far too small than what's necessary. For example, 15 years ago, the United States tried to put an export embargo on cryptographic software and said, OK, you can export all this code as long as you use only 40-bit keys, because then we're good. Because 40-bit keys are so easy to brute force. And to answer which key size is correct and sufficient, there are luckily many standardization organizations, and there's a web page called keylength.com, which basically aggregated all the recommendations, and you can pick and choose what you want to use. The bottom line seems to be that all of these values were generated with me wanting to be secure by the year 2020. And in a nutshell, it boils down that for symmetric ciphers like AES, if you use a 128-bit key size, you're probably good to go. So the suggestions go from 86 bits to 112 bits. For asymmetric ciphers, for example, in SSL certificates, you should be good to go if you use 2048-bit keys, goes down from 1800 to 2048. So this should be fine. 4K 4K certificates are also fine, but mostly incur much more computational overhead when establishing a TLS handshake. And for hash sizes, they mostly agreed on something larger than 200, 224. So if you use SHA-2 with 256 bits, you should be good to go. But this also means that SHA-1, which only produces 160-bit outputs, should be phased out rather sooner than later. So this is just a list of recommendations, and as soon as more information gets available, this is also updated. What's very important is that you should use clients which only accept strong cipher suites. This is usually not an issue if you use current browsers, because browsers are currently in the spotlight of all this debate, with very much attention to detail to make sure that they only select good ciphers. If we move away from browsers to mail clients or command line clients like curl, things get considerably worse. And if you look at custom applications, like stuff written in Ruby or Python, all bets are off anyhow, because, for example, Urlib2, which is one of the most convenient Python 2 HTTP libraries, doesn't do any validation on HTTPS certificates at all. So if the handshake succeeds, everything is fine. It doesn't check the certificate at all. Same with Ruby. Up until, I think, 2.1, it allowed cipher suites which were unauthenticated in the TLS handshake, which basically opened it up to man-in-the-middle attacks, even though it's using correct ciphers and everything. So this was also only closed down 3 or 4 months ago. So then this is also a strong incentive to actually update these libraries and these binaries. Fifth, configure servers that only offer strong cipher suites, because even if you've got clients which default to insecure ciphers, if you prevent from using them, then you can also prevent information leaks. This is a very complex and convoluted topic, and it's best to orient yourself on the guidelines from bettercrypto.org. I've got a few examples later on in the slides. And probably the most important step, even after today, or after Heartbleed, is that you should use forward secure cipher suites where possible. Forward secure cipher suites are cipher suites where the key used to encrypt the session isn't derived from the private key of the server, but it uses an ephemeral one, which is just used for this single TLS session and then thrown away. This is rather important, because if you don't use forward secure cipher suites, it's easy to decrypt all recorded encrypted traffic if you get a hold of the private key of the server. This happened, for example, in the case of LavaBit, which was the email provider used by Edward Snowden, where he got a court order which said, in addition to your personal appearance, you are directed to bring to the grand jury the public and private encryption keys used by LavaBit.com in any SSL or TLS session. Which is probably something you don't want to see in your post. For the cipher suites, the thing to look out for is DHE or ECDHE, which stands for Diffie-Hellman in the ephemeral version, or elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman. So if you've got a cipher suite which has this in it, you are most likely forward secure. And if you adhere to these 6 rules, you should be mostly good to go, at least from our current knowledge. And I've also prepared a few examples to look at how this looks like in the real world with daemons you can configure. These are all based off bettercrypto.org, which is a list of best practices peer-reviewed by people from the cryptography research environment, from systems administrators, and also the maintainers of this specific implementation. So those should be rather safe. And the most important thing they worked on was to define a cipher string which only offers strong ciphers. They dubbed this cipher string P, which where they tried to support the strongest available ciphers on a common set of platforms. Problem with the common set of platforms is that it excludes Windows XP and Java 6 clients. So if you need to support those, you need to extend it a bit. And an example for Apache, taken from the manual, is this. Where we on top, where we've got this SSL certificate file and certificate key file statement, which probably everybody knows. SSL protocol limits the available protocols where we disable SSL v2 and v3 since they're already broken or undesirable to use. On a cipher order, basically it tells the server to ignore any wishes the client has on what cipher should be chosen, because up until TLS v1, the client actually could send a suggestion to the server which the server had to honor. And with this, the server basically says, okay, I'm just going to use what I want to use. The SSL compression off here is just a recommendation, basically instruct the server to disable all compression on the TLS level to prevent the crime and breach style of attacks which used encryption bias information to deconstruct the private data. And down there, we've got an HSDS header which enables strict transport security. This is something which shouldn't be taken lightly, because this instructs the client to only use HTTPS in the future to connect to this specific domain. This is very helpful to prevent HTTPS downgrading attacks. For example, if you've got a proxy between your user and your server, where the proxy does all the HTTPS traffic and sends only HTTP links and traffic to your end user, this would be possible at the moment. But with HSTS, you can instruct the web browser to only use HTTPS. And this is, for example, something Google uses internally. For example, if you've got a Google Chrome browser, there's a list of domains hard-coded for which Google will, the Chrome browser will only talk over HTTPS. So it's even impossible to use HTTP for these domains. And this is rather sticky. I think this is 6 months. So if you misconfigure your server, send out an HSTS header, you either get HTTPS file support in a fast manner, or you figure out how you're going to tell all your users how to clear this HSTS cache. And this can even be extended to the all the subdomains of this domain. And last but not least, you've got this cipher string B out of the manual, which is basically this long list of supported and unsupported ciphers, which should make sure that only ciphers are chosen which are very hard to crack. For postfix, the world looks a bit more complicated, because mail is a rather convoluted topic. Most mail servers operate in two different roles. One is as a mail submission agent, accepting mail on behalf of your user, usually authenticated, and as a mail transmission agent. For mail submission agents, the Better Crypto.org team suggests that you use a separate port, the mail submission port, listening on port 587, with strict authentication for all users and strict encryption for all sessions. So that there's no concept of local users in the private LAN anymore, but to make sure that all of these connections are encrypted. And also use a rather locked down cipher string if all of your mail clients are recent. For the mail transfer part, actually exchanging email with other mail servers, it's still a bit bleak, because the best you can do nowadays is opportunistic encryption, which basically states that if the remote mail server supports encryption, use it. If it doesn't support it, don't use it, and don't even try to validate the certificate, because otherwise your users won't get any mails anymore. So for the mail transfer agent part, it's just using opportunistic encryption. And if you deploy a new mail server, please do not use self-signed certificates, because the more self-signed certificates are out there, the harder it's actually to turn on certificate validation on some point in the future. So for the actual configuration, postfix is a bit chatty. We've got a cert and key file up here. For the global MTA part, we enable opportunistic encryption by stating the TLS security level should be set to may, so may or may not. With TLS out only, we can lock down so that only username and passwords can be transferred over encrypted channels. And this is the lockdown for the mandatory protocols. So if we enforce encryption, only these protocols, so basically everything except SSL v2 and v3, and again our cipher string, which I truncated, is used. And to override these settings up here, we can spawn a separate SMTP daemon on port 587. Which is configured in a master configuration file in postfix, which basically says TLS security level should be set to encrypt. And with preempt cipher list, we again ignore the cipher suggested by the client and use the strongest supported one. And the hardy change for once is Dovecot, because Dovecot is a rather recent IMAP daemon. It's already comes with lots of sane defaults. The only thing you should consider is, again, locking down the cipher list if your client supports it. Another important thing is not to configure the server, the servers and daemons correctly, but also to see if you've missed anyone. Unfortunately, there's no comprehensive TLS scanner suite there already. Well, except tools like Nessus, which are commercial software, but in the open source world, it's still pretty bleak. Nmap is a pretty good start, because it's very efficient, and I think everybody knows Nmap in here, efficient scanner, which also has Lua support since a few years, which means that you can basically script anything you want. And for example, there's already a version scan which then connects to each open port, lists the service which is answering the, and for ports doing implicit SSL, it can already highlight that there's SSL listening. What's currently missing is an extension which does a start TLS on each port, which could support start TLS, to see if you can do a TLS upgrade, because then this is all again a service which needs to be checked, for example, like SMTP or IMAP, which both could support start TLS. Friend of mine already stated that he wanted to work on a script to, which offers start TLS support, and I'll include it in the link list as soon as he's got anything to show for. NMAP also has an enumeration plugin to see which cipher suites are offered by each server. But there's a far better tool for this out there, which is called SSLWise, maintained by Isaac Partners, which is a security consultancy company. It's a Python-based SSL scanner, which is pretty nice to automate, since it can dump all the output it produces into an XML file, which you can then further process. It comes with a bundled OpenSSL version, which makes it a bit pesky to deploy. But other than that, it works fine. And it will produce output like this. So in the top, we've got the call SSLWise PI with the option dash dash regular, which basically sets all of the interesting options. And if we connect to an HTTPS server, it will then dump out, basically, if compression is supported, which would be bad nowadays, if secure renegotiation or unsecure renegotiation is supported. And again, for each of the TLS protocols, all the cipher suites which are offered by the server and the one which is preferred. So this gives you a quick check if what the cipher suites look like and if there are any ones in there which you probably don't want to use anymore. So for example, most of the cipher suites offered by this server already are forward secure, indicated by the DHE. And a few ones which don't offer it to support legacy clients. And since this output is very technical, and sometimes you just need management compatible material, there's also quite a few web services which you can use for services which are open to the internet. The most prominent one is probably the SSL Labs.com web tester, which gives you a nice graded score from A to F. There's a version. There's a checker for Java servers, also for SMTP, which can be extended to other protocols as well, and also a very quick test for web browsers called howsmyssl.com, which gives you a quick check what your browser can supports and doesn't support. Unfortunately, there is no modern version of SSL dump. SSL dump was basically a tool which was able to dump SSL connection, and if you provided with a key, could also decrypt the communication. But it would be really nice to have a tool which you could run on your network edge, which listens in on all TLS handshakes, and which could complain that when a client uses a weak cipher suite, so that you can find out who's using this, operating the client, operating the server, and fixed it. To my knowledge, there's no free tool for this. Commercial IDS, IPS solutions may be able to do this, but I think this would be an interesting development for the future. And I think this is all of the material I've prepared for today. I'd like to say thanks to the BetterCrypto.org team, which went to great lengths to try to condense all this complicated matter into a few actionable small items. Especially Aaron Zauner, who's also working on the BetterCrypto.org team, who reviewed my slide decks up so far. All the people devoting their time for security research to make sure that the things we are using are actually working as we think that they do, and also you for listening. You can find all the links and material and media postings and so on at tinyurl.com/cryptolinks. And if you've got any questions or corrections, now's the time for this. Okay, everybody stoned.
I think that's called epic silence.
Otherwise, either in the hallway track or in the evening. Oh.
How do I convince management to get somebody to really specialize on this topic? Because I don't think that any one person or team can do it like a side job.
I think the major issue is that it's a rather complicated topic, and as I said, in the past you needed to be an expert on this. So I think what should be necessary is that everybody at least understands the basics. For example, look at how a TLS handshake looks like, what a Cypher suite does on a very high level basis, and for the rest, there are all the recommendations at, for example, bettercrypto.org, which at least gives you something actionable. If you need more than that, I don't really have best strategies, but I think there are lots of security consultancy companies who can suggest you strategies. For example, with the Heartbleed bug, it was pretty obvious to convince management to do something about this, because you just needed to show them a screen dump of a TLS session where you saw the username and password of one of your users logging in. So most bank, for example, I think in Austria we had 3 banks who were vulnerable to this, and 2 of them were patched within 3 or 4 hours, which is light speed when you look at banks. One of them, I think, is still vulnerable at the moment, but I think they don't deserve any better. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Michael.